My name is Phyllis Wakiaga. I'm the Chief Executive Officer of the Kenya Association of Manufacturers. Three words that describe me: I am God-fearing, I am passionate, and I am fun.
Interesting. Mm-hmm. And so you work in an industry in manufacturing here.
Yes.
I know there's women representation in different sectors, and women mm-hmm. maybe in terms of being SME, you know, SME oriented, mm-hmm. other women in leadership positions. Mm-hmm. But then honestly, the industry is quite crowded with the other gender, the male gender. And we still have a long way to go, sometimes in different sectors, in terms of representation. But then so far we can see we're doing good in terms of women empowerment in this country. Mm-hmm. I'm just curious, how is it though working in a male-dominated industry? And how has it been? Yeah, basically for you, how has it been navigating this industry? Mm-hmm. And yeah, so far what do you say about
Just confirm that CAM as a secretariat is mm-hmm. not male dominated. Okay. As the secretariat, nice. We are equally balanced. In fact, at some point, women uh-huh. were 60% uh-huh. as a secretariat.
Okay. Uh-huh.
But manufacturing as a sector is
yes.
male dominated. Because a lot of the careers that uh-huh. guide or lead towards manufacturing uh-huh. have typically been male dominated and have been perceived in some cases as more male oriented careers or sectors or stuff. So because of that, the sector is now mm-hmm. trying to transform and bring in more women on board, mm-hmm. Both at the workplace and at leadership level.
Mm-hmm.
As Kenya Association of Manufacturers, we are also being deliberate about that. So
what
we've done, we are running a program called Women in Manufacturing that is helping women to get more into the manufacturing sector.
Yeah.
And to scale them up, first of all, from SMEs to bigger businesses. Because a lot of women businesses play in the SME sector and really don't grow.
That's true.
And then typically also you'll find them in certain manufacturing sectors.
Okay.
There are now even within manufacturing, there are some that are even now more male dominated.
Okay.
So we're also trying to see how we can just say, how do we get more mm-hmm. women participating in these sectors, in leadership positions, as business owners, and even on the shop floor. That's I think critical, because eventually these entrepreneurs will come from the shop floor, will come from leadership within the sector. So if we are able to turn that around more, so the chair of the Women in Manufacturing program, Flora Mtai, was the chair of CAM, and we started the program together. She was the chair lady.
Tough question for you, I'm going to ask. So do you believe women should work twice harder to achieve what you have achieved so far? Tough question.
I worked hard. I don't know if I worked twice as hard. But I think in life, we should work hard.
Twice harder?
In a number of cases, women do have to put in more. That's a reality and fact that you'll hear echoed a lot. That we have to put in more, because a lot is expected, unfortunately, because of the societal constructs around gender.
That's true.
And in some cases, the female gender does have to prove itself much more.
Much more.
But generally in life, because I grew up with brothers, and we all need to work hard, and society unfortunately does make it sometimes more demanding for women, especially because of all the other roles we hold, and still having to perform as a mother, a wife,
that's true.
A career
so
woman.
Many roles,
so you're
one,
also
one
always
person.
Juggling so much more, so you have to put in a lot.
That's true. I was looking at a meme recently of a lady who's having all those roles and then put in the same platter as a guy who's also, you know, you're just going to work every day, but then the woman is the mother, the wife, the, you know, I agree.
But the good thing is God is quite fair because he's given women some serious multitasking skills.
I agree 100%.
And some serious intuition and certain things. So there are certain things that give us also that advantage. So God is very intentional when he does some of these things also.
He knew that he would be able to bear all this. That's good. That's nice. I'm just curious in regards to life, you know, I'm looking at how people have been talking about mentorship and how mentorship is important.
Yes.
And one thing I learned from you online is the journey you've gone through has also been through people identifying, you know, you from the onset and saying, okay, we know we can see her potential, and, you know, you try and, you know, you've been moved along the way, not just by yourself, but people, other leaders, being intentional about mentoring you to who you are today. Maybe you can talk about the importance of having a mentor and just being able to be an open learner, as we're trying to grow, as you're trying to, because I'm sure somebody's looking at you today and thinking, wow, I want to be like her one day, but then there's that aspect that they need to really, you know, check themselves. Are you really open to learning and, you know, trying to be learn from somebody else's experiences to go to get to where you are?
No, I love learning and I'm very open. I remember growing up, one of the things my mom would always say, I'm very argumentative also.
Okay.
Well, at least I used to be. She would say the good thing with Phyllis is at the end of the day, she listens. She'll eventually go think through and learn and implement and, you know, do those type of things.
Yes.
And for me, my journey of mentorship has been about that. I've learned from everyone around me. I'm those ones who absorb information, knowledge, and really try and learn.
Okay.
And books have also been a great mentor to me, because sometimes it's possible to get mentored by Michelle Obama without meeting her.
That's
by just
true,
reading
Becoming.
And understanding how she went about her life. So for me, books have been a great mentor.
Okay.
I've had great mentorship in someone like my mother, who is a professional, who has also worked through her entire life.
Okay.
And has been very disciplined. She's a doctor in psychology, so she's also been very good in terms of mentorship. My auntie Florence, who's her sister, my you know, so from a societal perspective, and then from a career perspective, a number of people I've worked with have been very good mentors. My bosses at Kenya Airways, whether it was Anthony Mwangi, Julie, the current CS, CS Betty Maina when she was at KAM, my board of 17,
17 members
who over the time have really just been available to guide, to coach, to mentor. So for me, I don't take mentorship as let's have a mentorship session, because I've actually never had that formal mentorship session. But all my experiences, interactions, asking questions, asking for advice, all that put together. And my big brother, I have a big brother who's been, from the time we were kids, a serious mentor, and someone who has also shaped a lot of what I've become over life. So for me, I see mentorship as that broad, the ability to just learn from those around you.
Okay, and so now you're looking at society today and the women around you, young, old, mid-aged, something you've seen or maybe you want to speak about or advise on, what would that be?
For women, it's really to just say the sky's the limit. And we shouldn't limit ourselves or say that this is something that's not for me, it's for men, or anything like that.
I agree.
But really to ask women to embrace the opportunities that exist.
Mm-hmm.
A lot has changed, and we've seen it change before our own eyes, because in our generation we have seen the issues of gender start to be addressed. We are not where we need to be, but a lot more opportunities have opened up in our day than existed, say, in our mother's days and that, all that. So it's really to say, can we take advantage of these opportunities? And one of the ones I'm most passionate about is the manufacturing sector. Because as I said, we have very few women actively playing in the manufacturing sector. And when they're there, a number of them are SMEs. So really, can we just get more into manufacturing? Can we grow our businesses? Can we do what we can to contribute to industrialization in this country? Because the things we do, even in our houses, cooking is actually industry. So you can turn that into something that is industrialization. So our day-to-day lives give us opportunities that we can leapfrog and take advantage of.
So
I just want to encourage women to go out there, take advantage of these opportunities, let their voices be heard wherever they are, and let us also, for those of us who've gotten to positions, champion the issues that still need to be addressed, because this is a journey. The previous generations have brought it until here, and we also have a role to take these issues to the next level, even as women, and also not to eventually leave the male child behind.
Yeah.
I have more boys. I have three boys and one girl, so I'm also interested in still.
That's true.
Eventually, still
empower the same. You know, in the male. I get that. That's interesting.
Mm-hmm.
And now there's Phyllis now, and then there's Phyllis in the future. But before even we get to that question, I'm thinking about this period right now, telling somebody, encouraging them to start their own business and maybe improve, you know, in terms of join the manufacturing industry and start a business. And then there's this corona that just happened, a whole pandemic, you know, and people were taken aback. Maybe they had the year beginning, oh my God, 2020 is my year, the year will do it. And then now there's this, you know, pandemic that has happened and taken everybody aback. And some are really going through so many challenges. Maybe just a positive word you can say on the same. Encouraging somebody today. That, you know, you don't worry. You know, it's never really the end of the road as you see it.
No, you know, the pandemic, I think, is new for all of us. In my lifetime, there has not been a pandemic. So for all of us, I think majority of us, we are living through something that we don't know, that we don't understand. And I know it's been challenging for everyone. It's a very stressful period for society and all of us. But it's really just to say that society has made it through pandemics in the past, has made it through difficult times. And I'm sure that even for this one, we'll make it out of the same. During this season, what I think Corona has done for everyone is made us introspect. As individuals, as countries, everyone is looking inward, basically. So it's a good time to think through what life is, what opportunities exist, areas that we can take advantage of, business ideas. You know, this is really a time to sit and introspect on some of those things. It might not be, maybe for some people they won't be able to implement those things now, but all these dreams start with with just that vision, and and that ability to think through. So take advantage of this moment, because of the social distancing and the limited movement, you have a bit more time to really just sit and reflect about your goals, your vision in life, and what you want to achieve. And don't waste this opportunity. Learn a new skill also. Do something
That's
different
true.
During this time. But I'm sure we'll come out much stronger.
So now back to my other question. There's Phyllis now and there's Phyllis of the future. What more are you looking forward to? I mean, after where you have gotten, if I'm looking at myself in my shoes, if I get to where you are, I think I would relax a bit. But I don't think you're relaxed, because you don't look like you're relaxed. There's still more you're looking forward to.
No, God giving me life, I hope to continue to influence and make a difference in society. I hope to continue to do it from a policy space, because I think that's a lasting difference. If you're able to do things that change policy, that change laws, those are things that can have impact
and it serves the future generations.
That's
true.
I'm keen to see Kenyan industry thrive. I'm keen to see more manufacturing happen in Kenya, where we'll be seeing manufacturing is 50% of our GDP and agriculture sector growing. So I'm very keen about
good vision for this country. Vision.
And not just for Kenya but for Africa, because I think this is Africa's moment. So those are some of the things I still that are still yet to be done. So at a personal level, I would love to be part of the journey that contributes to Kenya becoming a real manufacturing engine of Africa, and to see Africa trade more with each other and really just Pan-Africanism. You know that spirit of Kwame Nkrumah in the 50s of seeing a united Africa. So all those things are not yet done. So for me, I'm just the CEO of CAM.
It's something.
There's more things that need to be done in society that I would love to be a part of.
Spoken like a lawyer, I must say. Spoken like a lawyer. So just to understand you better, countries you travel to that you loved the most?
Italy. I love
Italy. Really?
Yeah, I think it's beautiful. The culture, the stories, visiting the many chapels, going to Firenze, eating pizza and nice ice cream. So I did love Italy.
Okay.
Yeah, that was amazing. I love Morocco. I've been to Morocco. Also, okay, amazing nice. Country. Moved from Casablanca to Marrakesh by road, so wow. I got to see a lot on the ground. So those are two countries I think.
Okay.
That I love. I like America because there's family there, so you're able to hang out with people.
Okay, yes. That's nice. Yes. So other than that, basically when it's a low day, like a really low day for Phyllis, what does Phyllis do? And just, you know, she gets grounded and comes back to herself, like a smiley self, and is like, I'm ready to do this, lead KM and be, yeah, everything that you always wanted to be. So where do you go back? You fall back and then now you know.
On dealing with issues, I'm a bit of an introvert and I believe in being self-driven and drawing energy from yourself.
Yeah.
So a lot of the time when I'm low, that's one of the things I do. I go back to myself.
Yeah.
I introspect. I try and understand what is bothering me, why it's bothering me. One person who's a good sounding board is my husband. So I talk to him and, you know, just and he listens and I just sound it out and eventually resolve my problem in the conversation.
In the conversation yourself, you're like, okay.
And I'm, oh yeah, that was the issue. Or I journal.
Yeah.
The time I used to journal a lot. I journaled all my life. Nowadays, I guess
my
I journal much less.
Journaling is quite private. It's talking to yourself at the realest level.
Yes.
My worry is always, what if somebody finds this notebook?
Just try and keep it safely.
Yeah.
Or sometimes even just write and destroy it.
And destroy what you've
But it helps you clarify your thoughts.
Yeah.
Yeah, then I also pray if something is really bothering me and if... I'm able to, I'll sometimes even read the Bible because the Bible has lessons on everything, answers on everything, even for today. So sometimes I talk to my friends and sometimes I just wake up, put on my makeup and move on, you know, because sometimes if you stay in bed and mop over it.
It's true, but then I've had that. If you dress well and you look good, you feel good.
And wear red like you. On that day, you just wear red or yellow and move on.
Color.
You just pick up automatically. But of course, try and address whatever it is bothering you at that time. Yeah.
You mentioned you have 3 amazing sons and 1 daughter. And I don't want to leave this interview before asking what you really are trying to impart in them, you know, what really you're trying to teach them. There are many things you can teach as a parent, but then there's just one thing you want them to always say, my mother taught me this and I will hold this to the last. What would it be?
For me, the most important thing I'm trying to teach them is to have a relationship with God, because I believe that that transcends everything. And whether or not I'm there, there'll be that guy they can go back to and, you know, and really just have a personal, private discussion with. So it's something I'm trying to instill in them. Also respect for each other, respect for others, discipline, hard work.
Yeah.
Those are some of the things. And then practical life skills. Cook, spread your bed.
important.
Help in the house. You know.
Be considerate. Understand. Okay,
So just good, normal African upbringing.
Okay. Thank you so much. I really like the idea of a spiritual self because that's the journey that I'm always on. And I really like that you're grounded on that. And I think it's one thing that has made you who you are. And... I'm thankful. Thank you for your time. Thank you for everything. I wish you all the best and, you know, keep doing what you're doing out there, supporting, leading the women, leading the men, leading the world as it is. Go on with what you're doing. I thank you so much for everything.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your time.
Yeah.
Yeah. God bless you too and have a lovely afternoon.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks.
That was Phyllis Wakiaga. She's the CEO of KAM. Very interesting lady to talk to. And I'm glad that you're able to watch to the end. If you've liked the video, I'd like to invite you to kindly share, like, and subscribe to our channel. But a special thank you to a number of people today. I want to first thank you, KAM, for the opportunity. Roslinda, for example, who's really helped us to organize this interview. And also for the time that we've had with Phyllis Wakiaga. A special thank you to Mesh Events Guru. For the production, the directing and also editing the video. Bonte Media for the provision of the cameras and equipment. And also to all of you, our viewers, we want to just say thank you. We appreciate your support. And keep on keeping on. Bye-bye.